Hello, everyone. Thanks for coming to my talk, and thanks for staying so late. Whenever the conference organizers ask me to give the last talk, I always wonder if I'm so good that I'm going to keep the people, or I'm so bad that they put me at the end. So I hope it's the first. Have any of you ever run into the situation that your application, service, or library has slowed down, and you didn't know why? Raise your hands, please. Okay, so this is the right talk. Something about myself. I'm one of the benchmark.net maintainers. Last year, I've been talking here about benchmarking. And for the last 2 years, I've been working at Microsoft on the .NET libraries team, where my main job is to build performance culture, prevent regressions, detect them, solve them, and also improve the performance of .NET Core and other libraries. And basically, for the last 2 years, I have been profiling and benchmarking. I haven't touched CSS, I don't miss it. I haven't touched JavaScript, I don't miss it. And I haven't touched SQL, I kind of miss it. So when it comes to performance, we should not be guessing, we should be measuring. So the first rule is measure, measure, measure. Because without data, you are just another person with an opinion. And we have two kinds of tools, benchmark. Benchmark can only tell us how long does it take to run given code, while a profiler can tell us why does it take so long and what exactly was executed. And profilers are the most important part of every performance investigation. Today I'm going to talk a lot about profilers, but we should start first with the recommended settings. So first of all, you should always measure the performance of the release builds, because the debug builds have no optimizations enabled. So whenever you are deploying your application to production or to Nougat.com, please do it in release. The next thing that you should remember is, if possible, to recompile the code before profiling it. You can enable the debug symbol information, which is going to help the profiler to solve the symbols. Another thing is that in .NET Core 3.0, we have enabled tier compilation by default. And if you are not profiling application startup and you don't know how to properly warm up tier JIT because it has a complex heuristic, then I encourage you to by default disable it when profiling .NET Core 3.0 applications. The next thing that we need is a small repro case. So we should try to narrow down the problem. And just to give you an example, some time ago I have been assigned to find an issue of a regression in ML.NET. And I had two versions of ML.NET. One of them was, the old one was targeting .NET Core 2.2. The new one was targeting 3.0. So a lot of things have changed. Another thing was that in 2.2, we had tier JIT disabled by default. In 3.0, we had it enabled by default. And moreover, the new version was using a managed library for vectorized math. So these were my first three guesses where things could go wrong. So what I did to narrow down the problem, I have disabled tier JIT and run the benchmarks again. By doing this, I have made sure that the tier JIT is not the source of the problem. Then I have updated the version of .NET Core of the old application to target 3.0, run the benchmarks again. Again, it was not the problem. So I was able to quickly narrow down the problem to vectorized math library. And my profiling has been focused on this particular part. Once we have a small repro case, we should choose the right profiler. And if you are developing on Windows and you can reproduce the issue locally, then I really encourage you to use Visual Studio Profiler. If the issue occurs at Windows and you still cannot reproduce it locally, then I encourage you to use Purview. Purview is production ready. It's the most powerful .NET profiler. On every other OS, you can try .NET Trace, and on Linux, if you care about native code stacks, you can use Perf Collect. And now I'm going to demo all of them for you. So who of you have ever used Visual Studio Profiler? Awesome. Visual Studio Profiler is very easy to use. And if you have Visual Studio, it's right there. It's installed. It's part of Visual Studio. So we go to the debug window, menu item, and we choose Performance Profiler. And now, every performance investigation should start with CPU investigation. If during the CPU investigation we find out that the problem is that we spend a lot of time in GC, then we check the .NET object allocation tracking. If we find out that we spend time in doing database, we go with database. For other I/O issues, we can go with the instrumentation option. So we basically always start with CPU usage. And just small reminder, release, not debug, and all of the recommended settings enabled. So now I'm pressing start, and Visual Studio is profiling my small repro case. One very important thing, the app should run for at least a few seconds so the profiler gathers enough samples to have something meaningful to show. And what the program is doing doesn't really matter. I just want to focus on the tools. So as you can see, we have a fancy report. We got functions, names, module, and the most important information, total CPU time and self CPU time. So what is total or inclusive CPU time? This is at the time when given method was on the call stack. So if you think of main method, it should be close to 100% of CPU inclusive time. The self CPU time, or otherwise exclusive CPU time, is when given method was actually executing. It was the last thing on the call stack. And when we are running a performance investigation, we are looking for top exclusive time contributors. So the methods that do spend most of the time doing CPU. So the first thing that we need to do, we can just simply sort the methods by CPU time. And here I can see that 36% of time was spent in this particular method. So this is my first performance bottleneck. The alternative is to drill into the details from main method. And as you can see over here, I'm getting an error saying source information is not available. So recently, Visual Studio Profiler has changed the way it loads symbols. Previously, all the symbols were preloaded when we were opening the report. But for the performance reasons, now it's being done on demand. So we need to actually click on a method from given module and select load module symbols or select load all symbols. And now when I get back to the color code review, I can see CPU time spent per given method. This is the inclusive time. And this is one of the, this is the biggest advantage of Visual Studio Profiler. So you can very easily see where the time was exactly spent. So instead of guessing and trying to change random pieces of my code, I'm using Visual Studio Profiler to tell me where the time was spent exactly. And if you can see over here, half of the time was spent in getNaturalColor method, another half was spent in getReflectionColor method. Now, from now, I could dig in into the details of both methods and find particular bottlenecks. But more or less, my investigation here is done. I have found two methods that spent most of the time. As I said, when we find out that most of the time was doing GC, we should run a memory investigation. But the memory profiler has a bigger overhead because it's attaching to an event for every object allocation. So every object that we allocate, profiler gets an information about this. So now I'm going to go to main method and change the number of invocations of my sample app from 500 to 10, because I just want to get information what exactly is being allocated and by whom. So again, performance profiler, I have to unselect this, select that, and we start. What Visual Studio Profiler is going to show us is the number of garbage collectors, collections, how many objects have been collected, and how many have survived. The problem is when the number of survivors is big, and this information is available in the collection tab. As you can see, we have almost the same objects being survived all of the time, 254, and with every GC, 10,000 were typically collected. Another very interesting information is in the allocation tab. So which type was the most frequently allocated? And as you can see, we have allocated only 34 strings, few vectors, but the most frequently allocated type was ray packet 256. So if GC was the problem for me, I would make sure that I allocate less instances of this type. Maybe I could make it a class or a value type instead of a class. Okay. And here I can see which method have been allocating this particular type. So render vectorized and get natural color. We also can get this information in a form of a call tree where every method has their weight of how much memory was allocated. And one great thing about Visual Studio Profiler is that it doesn't only support C#, it also supports C++. It supports .NET Core and full .NET framework. So whatever we are doing with .NET, you can use it. And when it comes to memory, both managed and native allocations are being tracked. The next profiler that I want to talk about is Purview. Have any of you ever used it or heard of it? Okay, fewer people. This is bad and good at the same time. So Purview is the most powerful .NET profiler. I would call it the ultimate .NET profiler. It's open source and it's being actively maintained and developed. And moreover, the .NET runtime team is contributing to Purview. So anytime we get some new features in .NET Core, like tiered compilation or some new GC flavor, the person who is implementing this feature is typically also contributing to Purview to make sure that she or he can analyze the performance impact of that new .NET runtime feature. But the biggest advantage of Purview is that it's production ready. So first of all, it's just a single executable file signed by Microsoft. But the second thing is that it has a very small overhead. When you're using the default settings, it has something from 3 to 5% of the overhead. And this profiler is very, very frequently used at Microsoft, and most of the software engineers who ever run into an issue with .NET performance in production have used it at least once. The most important information about Purview, when you open it, you have two very important links, link to a tutorial and tutorial videos. So Vance Morrison, a .NET performance architect, has recorded training videos about Purview where he explains exactly how it works and how to use it. So anytime you get to the point that you don't know how to continue further using Purview or the tool simply seems to be too complex, you should just watch these videos. They are for free. They are available at channel9.com. And now let's profile something. Purview gives us two options. We can either run a standalone executable, which is great when we care about startup time, execution time, and runtime time, or we just have a small repro case. And it also allows us to collect profile data with explicit start and stop. So when dealing with issues in production, I typically go with collect. However, for the purpose of this presentation, I have a standalone executable. So all I need to do is to provide the path. I don't want Purview to zip the trace file. And I'm just going to mention the advanced options. In 99% of the cases, you don't need advanced options. However, I want you to be aware of it. And now I'm just going to run the command. And over here, we can see very important button log. Anytime Purview is misbehaving or there is something that is surprising to you or you get an error and you don't have the full information in the dialog box with error information, you should go to log window. It has stopped the profiling. Now I'm interested mostly in CPU stacks. Another great advantage of Purview is that it's profiling machine-wide. It's using event tracing for Windows, which allows us to collect traces from all of the active processes. So what Purview offers us here is the list of processes which were active during the profiling. And it sorts them descending by CPU time. And luckily, our demo was the most busy application during the profiling. However, if you ever run into the situation when you have few microservices or other apps running on a Windows box and they communicate to each other and you want to get the big picture, you can use Purview to visualize the data of all of them at the same time. Also, if you ever run into the situation where your computer is slowing down and you simply don't know which process is the bad one, then you can use the collect option, profile it for 10 seconds, and over here you will see the most active processes. So I'm selecting profile demo app, and from here we need to first of all take a look at total metrics count. So as I said previously, with Visual Studio Profiler, we should run the profiling for at least a few seconds. By default, Purview captures a sample every millisecond. So if we have 8,500 samples, it means that it has been running for 8.5 seconds. And so, which is good. So the data that I can see is representative and statistically significant. The next thing that I typically do, I disable the grouping. As you can see over here, we have other, other. So by default, Purview groups the methods by modules. This is very useful when you are profiling something big in production and your application is using a lot of different components like AutoFac, Dapper, and Purview would then show you like 20% was spent doing Dapper queries, 5% doing AutoFac, et cetera, et cetera. But for the purpose of this presentation, I'm interested in all of the details. So I disable the grouping. And as you can see over here, we had some exclamation and question marks. So these are the unsolved symbols. And I have been practicing this presentation on this machine before. So there is only one unsolved symbol. But typically, when you open Purview for the first time and profile something, there is a lot of unsolved symbols. And to solve the symbols, you just right-click on them and select lookup symbols. And Purview has very powerful symbol solving. It's capable of solving the symbols not only for the thing that you have captured on your machine, but also for traces captured from different machines and also from different OSs. Because Purview allows you to open trace files captured on Linux with PerfCollect or .NET Trace. And it's capable of solving even the native symbols of some native Linux libraries. Okay. Once I solve the symbols, I'm interested in filtering the trace file by time. As you can see over here, the trace starts at time zero, ends at the 13th second, but we have captured the data from the process startup, execution, and rundown. And in this particular case, I'm not interested in startup, so I will just go to call tree and search for program and find the main method. It's over here, so I'm just right-clicking on this, and I'm setting the time range. So as you can see, the value has changed from 0 to 567. If I would care about startup, I would do the opposite. I would filter from 0 to 567. And then I would have the trace file filter to the startup execution time. And now let's talk about all of the tabs that Purview is showing us. The default tab by name, the most important tab. So it's showing us all of the methods sorted descending by CPU exclusive time. So all of the methods that were consuming most of the CPU are here. And whenever we are dealing with a very simple problem, like a deadlock or something, all these methods are right here at the top. And very often, my performance investigation using Purview ends right here. For example, some time ago, I have been investigating an issue reported by a customer, where it turned out that we had a lock that should have been removed. When I have profiled their application and opened the trace file with Purview, the first three methods were related to taking and releasing a lock. So it was kind of obvious. But right here, there is a method that I recognize, get natural color, which was spent like 20% of time. And there is also move small method. And I have no idea what this method is doing and who is calling this method. So I can right-click on given method, select go to, and go to callers. And by doing this, I can find out who has been calling this particular method. Another thing that we can do, we can also go to callies, call tree, or go to flame graph. And what is flame graph? Flame graph is a visual representation of call tree. Every box here represents a method from a call tree, and the width of the box is related to CPU inclusive time. And another great feature of Purview, folding. Folding means that take every node which is less than the value that I have provided and fold it into its parent. So by default it's 1%. If I set it to 5%, we can see that small boxes are gone. If I set it to 10, most of the noise is gone. So if you open a complex flame graph and you want to kind of focus on the biggest things, you can just set the folding to a different value. And as you can see, flame graph gives us a great overview, and more or less, we are looking for the big boxes. But one very important information, flame graph is showing an aggregated data. It doesn't tell us when these things happened. Okay, I just want to make sure that I haven't forget about something. I have forget. So as you could see, I could now find the main method and filter using it and set the time range. But what if I cannot find my method in the profile information? What does it mean? It might mean that the method got inlined, or it was executed for such a short time that the profiler didn't capture it using sampling. So what I sometimes do, I introduce a method with a really strange name like what I care about. I apply the no inlining attribute, then I start the profiling and I find it very quickly and easily using the find option in Purview. One more thing about flame graph. When you take a look at the boxes, as I said, each box width represents the CPU inclusive time. But for the leaf nodes, the width is also equal to exclusive time, because this is the last thing on the call stack. And the difference in the width between the parent and child box is the parent CPU exclusive time. When you think about it for a second, it kind of becomes obvious. Yes, another thing that I haven't mentioned is going to source. So Purview also gives us the possibility to go to source of given method. So I can select something and say, go to source. But as you can see, compared to Visual Studio Profiler, the text output that I'm getting here is kind of not rich enough. So Visual Studio Profiler is the most user-friendly .NET profiler, and it contains great information per code line level. Yes, another thing. So sometimes filtering by just a method name is not enough, because maybe we call the method 10 times and we only care about the one time when we actually have called it. So what we can do, we can define a new event source. Event source is a base class from the .NET framework, and we can emit our own events. And there are events for start and stop, for example, and we can add some condition to our code, where, for example, when given thing happens, signalize it with two events, start and stop. And then we can filter our trace using the events. And I'm going to show you how I'm using it to detect regressions in .NET Core itself. So here I have two traces. One was captured for .NET Core 2.2 and another for 3.0. These traces are output of benchmark.NET, which is reusing Purview internally, and it allows for profiling and benchmarking code at the same time. So I'm doing this very frequently, so I'm trying to automate my job. And I'm very interested in actual benchmark invocations, so I'm searching for the start and stop events. I find two of them, so it's one benchmarking iteration. I'm opening the CPU stacks, then I'm interested in .NET process, and I'm not setting the time range, I'm including the item. Okay. As you can see, I have some unsolved symbols. I select everything. I look up for the symbols. And in the meantime, I'm going to open the second trace file. I go to events. I find the event that I care about. I open CPU stacks, I include the item, I go to by name tab, I select everything, and I look up the symbols. And I'm moving the .NET Core 3.0 to the right and .NET Core 2.2 to the left. As you can see, the flame graph is quite complex. And now finding the regression between two different versions would be hard. Some people are capable of seeing the difference here. I don't. And Purview has a great feature, which is hidden. And it shows up when you have more than one trace file open. It allows you to compare two traces and tell you where the regression is. But one very important thing, you need to be comparing apples to apples. So you need to filter both trace files in the exactly same way, and both of them must execute exactly the same amount of work. And now I will just go with regression baseline, and it's telling me that 250 milliseconds was for .NET Core 2.2, and for 3.0 it was 306. And now it's sorting the methods, which are now taking more time. Again, descending, and I can see that a method called thread stack walk frames x used to take 5 milliseconds. Now it's taking 67 milliseconds. So I can click on 67, and it's showing me who is calling this method in the colors tab. Now I can just observe that 55 milliseconds was spent by calls from stack walk frames method. I press space, and I can see that this particular method is being called by getThread the serialization tracker. And this is the source of the regression. I have spoken to some people on the .NET team, and it turned out that this is a new security feature. So this actual performance regression is by design. However, you should not be worried about this because it's in a binary serializer, which is kind of not recommended to be used. But my point here is that, as you could see, we had two complex flame graphs, two complex traces, and the tool just shown us where the regression was. So anytime your app is getting slower with the new version, you just capture two trace files from the old and the new version and compare them using this feature, and the regression is right there waiting for you. Another great tool that I want to mention is .NET Trace. So .NET Trace is a new .NET diagnostic tool. It's a .NET global tool, so we install it using .NET CLI. It works on every OS in the same way. It's using an internal mechanism of Core CLR called EventPipe. It works exactly the same way on every OS. It works on .NET Core 3.0 and newer versions of .NET Core. You don't need to run it as administrator or sudo. However, it lacks the information about native call stacks. So how do we install it? We just run .NET tool install --global.net-trace, and it's installed. And the next thing that we need to do before we start the profiling, we need to find the list of actively running processes. So now I'm going to see which processes are running. Yes, so there is one .NET process. And now I'm going to modify my repro case and change the for loop to while true loop, because .NET Trace does not allow me to run an executable like Purview. I can only attach to a process which is already running. And now I'm going to run it without debugging in release, and rerun my command again. So as you can see, we get the ID of the process profiler demo. Now I'm just going with .NET trace collect dash p, and I provide the process ID. And now .NET Trace is profiling my app, and it works exactly in the same way on macOS and Linux and Windows. And whenever I believe that I have gathered enough information, I press enter, and it stops. What it has produced is a trace.NET Trace file. It's a new format of a trace file, but we can convert it to other formats, also using the .NET Trace tool. So I'm now going to convert it to a SpeedScope format. Okay, what is SpeedScope? SpeedScope is a modern web application, single page application that allows us for visualizing performance data. And I really didn't want to port Pervue to Linux. I was hoping that we can get something working very easily with very powerful visualization. And then I reminded myself that somebody on Twitter was recommending this tool. It's an open source tool. And moreover, as I said, it's a web app. However, it's not sending your data anyway, anywhere. So right now I'm going to disconnect from the internet. I'm going to go with the airplane mode. And there is a standalone version of this tool. It looks like Chrome has a performance regression in startup time. And now, if you would be curious about why Chrome takes so long to start up, you could use Pervue and capture the trace machine-wide and analyze it and load Chrome symbols using Pervue. However, we don't have time for doing this. Over here, you can see that I have saved an offline web version of SpeedScope. It's like 150 kilobytes. And as I said, it's not sending the data anywhere. I'm currently offline, and I'm using it to open the trace file. And let's start with the simple thing first. So the sandwich view is more or less a byname view from Pervue. So it's showing us all of the methods, again, sorted by CPU exclusive time. What is great about this tool is that it's very intuitive to use. So how do I go to colors colis? I just select given method, and it's showing me them right here. Left heavy is a flame graph, but I call it an upside down flame graph. So it's not from the bottom to the top, it's from the top to the bottom. So again, understanding it should be quite straightforward. And the third view, very important one, is time order. So what is time order? Time order is a very unique view because it's showing every single sample from the trace file as a separate thing on the graph. So we can see how our application was behaving over the time. Moreover, we can very easily filter it over the time. So as you can see, SpeedScope doesn't really require any kind of help, because what you would think you should need to do to filter something, you just do it and it just works. So as you can see, I can see exactly what was happening over the time. And honestly, sometimes when I'm very lazy and I run into some issues on Linux or Mac and I don't feel like I have a lot of time to attach a debugger, I just run .NET Trace, I convert it to SpeedScope, and I get a very good overview of what is happening with my application. But this particular application is single-threaded. If we would have more threads, we would have arrows here that would allow us for switching from one thread to another. Another important information, when we start collecting profile data using .NET Trace, we can specify the output format file upfront. So we don't need to even convert to SpeedScope. Moreover, we should also be able to open SpeedScope files in the latest version of Visual Studio. And it should show us it in a way it shows data in Visual Studio Profiler. Okay, I think I should profile something. So now I'm going to capture some data machine-wide while Visual Studio is hanging. After a few seconds, I can stop the collection. I go to CPU stacks, and Visual Studio was the second most active project, so I open it, and I can see that most of the time was spent in unknown module. Awesome. So I can disable the grouping, and now I can see that 93% of time was spent in Microsoft.webtools.languages.shared.ni. And from here, if I would be really interested why Visual Studio has just hung, I would look up for symbols and then repeat all of the things that I have been doing. So as you can see over here, 90% of the time is currently being spent in the parser. So most probably something is wrong with the parser, but as a Microsoft employee, I'm never using stable versions of Visual Studio. I'm always using preview versions of Windows, of Visual Studio. So things like that happen to me, but hopefully don't happen to you when we ship the final version of the product. So now I'm just going to kill Visual Studio. Perf collect. As I told you, .NET Trace allows us to profile data from process which is already running, and it doesn't contain information about native call stacks, and it contains information only about single process. And if you either need native call stack information or machine-wide profiling on Linux, then you should use perfcollect. It's an excellent script written by Brian Robbins, principal software engineer on the .NET team, who is dealing always with the most hardcore performance issues. The script internally uses LTTNG and perf events and is capable of solving .NET symbols, so it does all of the heavy lifting. Everything that you need to remember from this presentation is that it exists, and whenever you need these two kind of scenarios, you can use it. So we just download it and make it an executable and run a sudo with install command. Once we do that, we run the collect command also as sudo, and then we start our application, and whenever we believe that we have captured enough information, we are stopping the profiling with Control C. As a result, we are getting a trace file, but this particular trace file needs to be copied from Linux to Windows and opened with Purview. However, I believe that most of you will never really need to use perfcollect. What I really encourage you to do is to give a try to .NET Trace. So we have found a performance bottleneck, and what is the next thing? Most of the C# developers I know typically jump into with some ideas for micro-optimizations. But this is not the best way of dealing with performance issues. So first of all, you should try to get the big picture, and you should try to understand of what given program is trying to achieve. Because maybe you don't really need to call this method. Maybe you could call it less frequently, or maybe you know that the faster alternative exists. Maybe you can replace calls to array.contains with a dictionary. So you should, first of all, try to get the big picture and question the current design. And one important information, changing the architecture is always harder and more expensive. However, it can bring much bigger gains than any kind of micro optimizations. So once you have found the bottleneck, you have an idea, and you know what you want to change, what is the next step of performance investigation? Just a hint, when I interview people, everybody claims that they do it. Unit tests. The next thing, before you touch the code and you edit it, you should make sure that the test has that the code has good test coverage, because correctness is more important than performance. Whenever you are trying to improve the performance, you should make sure that you don't affect the correctness of the results produced by your application. And whenever you are asking for code review, you should really try to explain all of your decisions. It helps you to, first of all, build the performance culture in your .NET team. Everybody else on the team starts to learn the tricks from you, and over the time, you will learn from the other team members as well. Moreover, again, you need to make sure that you don't affect the results and try to not to push on the reviewers, because when you are changing something very complex, just to bring some performance gains, people are typically busy with more important things, like providing some business value, implementing a new feature, or making sure that a bug gets fixed. So please don't push on the reviewers, just to improve the perf. And just to give you a good example of how unit tests solved me recently. So some time ago, one of our customers has reported an issue with string starts with on Linux. And back then, it was 1 month ago, I had no idea how complex Unicode was. So I was like, okay, so how can we implement starts with in a very performant way? I can just take the string and a subslice of the string equal to the length of the prefix and do a binary comparison. So I have just sent a PR to CoreCLR, and one of our contributors quickly explained me that it's not going to work for some of the languages like French. And then I have decided to do the homework, and I have started studying Unicode. So first of all, in languages like French, we have characters which can be expressed with a single or two letters. In languages like Hungarian, Polish, in Czech, we have letters that can be expressed with two characters. For example, CZ. So CZ doesn't start with C. And moreover, we have combining characters, which change the meaning of the previous character. We have a null character, which on Linux means the end of the string. On Windows, it depends on how you want to treat it. Moreover, we have surrogate characters in Unicode, which combine together, again, create another character. And by the way, when I was trying to get my change merged, one of the code reviewers have written a tool that was doing a stress testing of the string starts with, and he was looking for possible bugs in my implementation. And by doing this, we have found a bug in the underlying native library in ICU, which was used not only by .NET Core, but also by projects like Chromium. And it turned out that if you would try to find out if a single letter string starts with a string which length is equal to unsigned integer 16 max value plus 1, you would get true. Why? It turned out that there was unsigned integer 16 overflow in the native library, and bug was there for 20 years. And actually, before I have merged my PR, I have sent like 3 to 4 pull requests with new unit test cases to CoreFX, then a bug fix to the native library, and then the actual performance improvement. So we have an idea, good test, and what is the next step in the performance investigation? The next step is to write some benchmarks, because benchmarks are going to answer the question if our fixes have actually improved the performance or not. Moreover, if you keep them, over the time, they will allow you to detect regressions and measure the performance. And now, until we are not happy about the performance, we apply the optimization, run the unit test to verify we didn't change the behavior, run the benchmarks to verify that we have actually improved the performance, and use a profiler to profile it more, analyze, and again, improve, 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 until the goal is not achieved. So every performance investigation should start with a small repro case. We should try to narrow down the problem, because it's going to make our analysis simpler. you should be always using release build with possibly debug symbols. On Windows, I really encourage you to always try Visual Studio Profiler first. If the issue is in production or you cannot reproduce it locally, go with Purview. And if Purview seems too complex to you, please watch the videos that I have mentioned from Channel 9. They're really great. I have learned everything about Purview by just watching those videos. If you are facing a .NET Core issue on Linux or macOS, I really encourage you to use .NET Trace. It should be the default choice. However, if you need information about native call stacks or you want to profile the data machine-wide, then you should go with Perf Collect. Once you have the data, you analyze it. And one very important thing that I forgot to say. When you are analyzing complex performance issues, don't blame yourself if you cannot find the problem in a few minutes. I very often analyze problems that sometimes it takes me minutes to solve, sometimes an hour, sometimes a few days, sometimes a few weeks. There are some performance problems on the .NET team that we have been actually trying to solve in a team for a few months, and we still don't really understand the complexity of the problem. So don't blame yourself if you don't know where the actual problem is when you are profiling a very complex application. Remember too that correctness is more important than performance. Have your unit tests ready and use benchmarks to validate the gains. Don't use the benchmarks and change a random piece of your code. Use a profiler to find out where the time was spent. Okay? So thank you, dziękuję, and have a nice weekend.